I'm Ron Bjork. We're at my ranch and in my house here on the ranch. I've been running this for years, and I also sell a little real estate, and I was a mortgage broker at a mortgage office, and also I was a contractor and a dealer, had a dealer's license, because we were selling some mobile homes at that time. So I had all those different licenses and stuff over the years.
This tore up right now. We're putting some new stalls in there for my grandson's steer and the pony.
Well, the reason we came to Oregon, we were in California. My granddad ran a big ranch for some folks in California for years and years, and it was in the process of being sold to be developed, and we had bought a ranch. My folks had bought a ranch in Nevada, in Smith Valley, Nevada, and we went up there. And we were farming there. It didn't take very long to get from Concord, California to Smith Valley, Nevada. We went up there on the weekends, and then I spent all summer up there. In the Nevada ranch, we had a situation where we could sell the water for more money than we could generate off of the ranch itself. And so what we did was we ended up selling the water, and we were looking for a place with really good water, and came to Oregon because Oregon has lots of water and I at least, you know, that's what the perception is. But we found this particular ranch, and it has really good water rights. It's very old water rights. And so we're, I think, about second out of the creek behind the mill in Eagle Point.
You can see how the creek is here. And we have a lot of cover. We had a problem with beavers, and the beavers were knocking the trees down, and I finally got the beavers. They're not an endangered species in Oregon. So we got rid of the beavers.
We moved in here, took possession of it, and our first year here was really 1960. First haying season, you know, first year. And we put hay up and that kind of stuff, and then we had a bunch of cows. We had over 100 cows in California, and we moved them up here. And
was the land clear?
Well, yeah. And we had more. We had the ranch across the street, another 80 acres, and then we had 460 acres up at the end of Worthington with some BLM that was with it. Anyway, we moved the cows up here, and then we kind of went along, and for a few years, and then Nevada Ranch, the water wasn't worth that any, so we had to do something. So I kind of went back and forth between Oregon and Nevada. And when I'd go over, I'd haul equipment over. And when I came back, I always brought a load of alfalfa, which, you know, it didn't sell for too much. I mean, about $25 a ton. And we'd put it on the truck and haul it over here, and we got more than that out of it, you know. So anyway, we started raising, went back, and that ground, we had to work it all up, and we put in grain, and one field or two, we actually went in and added to what alfalfa was there and planted alfalfa in oats. And we started raising onions because we got an onion contract. So for about 4 years, I raised about 350 ton of onions and some spuds on the ranch over there. And then we had a little piece leased out for garlic. And so they were raising garlic on the place. And then I got drafted in the military. And so things just sort of, I mean, we lost, well, we sold the range first. Then we ended up selling the Nevada ranch because there really wasn't anybody to do anything. My granddad was in his 80s, and he really couldn't do much, but he lived over here on the ranch. And so I went in the military, and they sent me to Germany, which was good during the Vietnam time. They were drafting people pretty right and left. I was class A because I wasn't married or anything, you know. And I tried to get a deferment because of the ranches, but no, they wouldn't see it. And I got in the military, and I'd put that request in, and about a year after I was in there, the judge advocate called me and said, "Say, you know, we shouldn't have drafted you." I said, "Well, gee, that's great." But it doesn't make a whole lot of sense right now for me to do anything. I might as well finish my term and get out. And so I did. And then when I got out, we still had this ranch over here. We'd sold everything else, the 160 acres left here. And I got out and went back, used the GI Bill, went to school, and ended up graduating from Cal Poly in San Luis Obispo, and with a degree in business. And then after that, I went to work for Bank of America in their appraisal department. And I was doing a lot of appraisals. I was in the Bay Area for about 18 months, and then I moved to Redding, which was great for me because I could get back up here on the weekends. And at about that time, or just a little before that, we sold 80 acres across the road. And my grandmother and grandfather moved close to my uncle and my dad down in California so they could take care of them. And so I was down there in Redding, and I'd come up on the weekends and started developing the ranch. Everything on this side of the ranch we built. All the barns, the shops, the you name it, we built it. So.
What year was that about?
Early 70s. Yeah, early 70s.
Did your herd grow or contract?
Well, it kind of went both ways, you know, and then in about, oh, I don't know, early 80s, I moved up here and I bought a bunch of cows, and then I bought some more cows, and I just seemed like I kept buying cows, and
selling them too, I expect.
And I had a couple of hundred acres, and I had a range over in on the Little Applegate, and then I ended up with a range next to it in Glade Creek, and so I'd haul my cows over there for the summer and then bring them back. And I had another ranch leased where the golf course is here in Eagle Point, out on 140. And so I'd move, you know, between those and some other places I had, we were getting bigger. And then the cow market went to pieces in the 80s. And so basically I sold all the cows and the range just to stay afloat, so to speak, because things were getting tough. I mean, the banks would have given me a loan, but I don't believe in putting a loan on your home place. I think it's free and clear. You need to keep it free and clear. So that's what we did. And I started back doing real estate. And I sold real estate, mainly ranches. then I kept on farming and kept building more cows up. It wasn't very long before I was getting more cows again. And so I'm running about 40 cows right now is about all. In the past, I've run several hundred head, but now I'm running about 40 cows. That's about what this place will handle. And I have another ranch leased up on Reese Creek. And so I have another 40 acres of meadow. And then this fall, I leased another place across the creek over here that abuts our place, and we run cows on all of those pieces, and then we brought the cows home. And so anyway, that's kind of a synopsis, you know, right up to date. In the meantime, I did some of those other things. I was a mortgage broker, had a mortgage office, and then when the real estate market started to turn around, I said, it's time to get out of this. I didn't the real estate because it was okay. But the mortgage business, I decided I could see what was happening, and we didn't do government-insured loans. We only did basically private money. When I say private, that doesn't mean that the large institutions like Wells Fargo and Bank of America and Security Pacific and a whole lot of lenders were still out there, and they all made private loans, but we could see, I could anyway, that it was not a thing to be in. So I got out, it was good timing when I got out. They had a rough go for a while there, but I had a dealer's license and a contractor's license, and we did a lot of repairs on mobile homes. When we had the mortgage business, it just seemed to fit. You know, sometimes things go together. And all that stuff kind of went together.
Good. Okay. That's perfect. See you then. Mm-hmm. Bye. Chutes and all that kind of stuff, we don't need to. We just jump them in the trailer now. And boy, it's just slick as a whistle. Goes quick.
When I first went to Farm Bureau meetings, I went with my granddad. It was just kind of a fun thing, you know, and it was down in Contra Costa County. And we just went to some meetings, and they talked about farming and interesting things. So I continued. When I got old enough, I had to get car insurance and this, that, and the other. And I could get a good rate with Farm Bureau, so I kept Farm Bureau. Just kept it right on from there on. I mean, I've been a Farm Bureau member most of my life, in one place or another. I was in Contra Costa County and Shasta County and Jackson County. When I came up here and here, came back, I was already a member of Farm Bureau. And when I actually moved back here, I decided I needed to go to a Farm Bureau meeting. They have some things of interest that they do at these Farm Bureau meetings. And they had a speaker that was a really good speaker. And so I went and visited with the people. And we had people like Homer Conger and some of those real neat older folks that were in it. Before too long, I was participating. I went to the state convention, and And then I became president at that time, and I was president for, 10, 15 years. We dealt with a lot of political issues, and of course the one thing that we always have been dealing with is water. Laws that affect us as far as farming is concerned. I know in the 70s we had the land use planning came in Oregon, and I think we had it about 72. I'm not sure exact on that time. But we had land use planning, and with the land use planning, a lot of the ranchers in this area, the old time folks who had typically sold off the corners, the 5 acres or the 2 acres that weren't productive, all of a sudden couldn't sell anything off, and being their property was downzoned, the banks had no choice but call the loans. And they were all operating with an operating loan from a lending institution, probably PCA and that kind of stuff. So lots of them went broke because there was no market at that time for that. And I kept going to Farm Bureau, you know. I opposed it, the land use thing, because it took away what we could do. It took a tool out of our toolbox. That was an important tool, and I could see these families that had been here came over in by wagon to Oregon and homesteaded in this area. How they lost everything because of the land use planning. And they always said, well, we were going to compensate everybody with that land use. They never compensated anybody. That's government. That's just talk. We started in the 70s with that land use, and it just killed people. It was really tough. Some of them made it if they were diverse enough at that time. They were able to withstand the loss in property value. And there was a tremendous loss in property value. And that's an issue that Farm Bureau has always been on. And Farm Bureau supports the people in the Willamette Valley think that the land use is wonderful. Because what's happened is, and I've seen this and talked to folks, well, they said the people next to us, you know, they might have developed that, but they couldn't. So they had to rent it to somebody, and I rented it from them. And I can remember hearing that a lot. Those people couldn't do anything else with their land. All of a sudden, it's all locked up in big chunks. And you can't do anything, and so you have to rent it to somebody or try to make your payments or retire. You couldn't retire, and you took that retirement benefit away from those folks. Jackson County had planning before we had land use planning, and most of Jackson County was planned just the opposite of what we ended up with when we got the LCDC and the mandate of what we had to do. We had the houses going to the hills and the less valued land, and the good farmland in the bottom would be saved. But then the cities got involved and they decided that they had to have the ability to expand and not go to the hills. They wanted to expand in the easy developed land, and so consequently what they did was they went ahead and got what you call urban growth boundaries. And so they put things in the urban growth boundaries, and of course the land that was in the urban growth boundaries went up in value because there is a supply and demand, and there is a small supply and a high demand. And so we got into this land use planning, and I can remember I was the chairman of a local citizen involvement committee, and I was also on the county I forget what it was called, another citizen type involvement. But we had county people telling us what we were going to do. They had some people that came to our meeting. They had a gal from Ashland that used to come to our meeting, and she told us what we were going to do. And we told her we didn't go along with that at all. That's not what we wanted, and we didn't want this. And so she quit coming because we invited her not to come to our meetings. And she got a job in planning later and, moved on up. We got stuck with what we got, and basically a lot of that was the Thousand Friends of Oregon were involved, and they were going to sue the county if they didn't do what they wanted. And at that time, we had some county commissioners that agreed with all this land use planning, and one of them got recalled. The other one, Isabel Sickles, was too close to the end of her time, so she didn't get recalled. But Carol Doty got recalled because of what they did to our county.
Jackson County Farm Bureau has been a leader in, at the time, opposing the county's plan on our land use planning. So that was an interest to me because it tended to keep the value of the farms with the people that owned it and not let the state take it away, but they did anyway. So that just goes to show you really don't own your land. They want you to be just a serf on that land. And that's basically what we are. I mean, we have a right to it, but we don't have much rights anymore. They keep taking it away. And Oregon, don't do that. And Oregon Farm Bureau is fighting for us in all kinds of ways to protect our rights as farmers. We're fighting, and we have the Wolf Initiative that we've been involved in. They're bringing the endangered wolf back. That's not even an endangered wolf. It's not even the kind of wolf that used to be here. But they brought them in anyway. And they're, harassing cows and causing problems. So Farm Bureau's involved in that. So we have a couple of packs up above, one by Howard Prairie and one up by Lost Creek, above Lost Creek Lake. The state has done away with their endangered species on wolves, but the federal government has not. They did do it in the northeast corner of the state. They took it away because there was so many packs up there, breeding packs, that they could do it away. So it's helped some because they can go through and get rid of the ones that are causing the problems. And that's a real problem. The animals tend to make the cattle and or sheep graze differently. They don't want to go out because they're going to be harassed, run by the wolves, and so they're afraid of them. So that was another issue. And water, of course, is always an issue with Farm Bureau, and it's been an issue as long as I can remember.
What regard?
Well, it seems like as we progressed over the years, there's been more and more confrontation over water with the state. And the state has they came up with a 10-10 program, which was a, or is a program, and it is in effect right now, that shall we say, graded the streams. And when I say that, some of the streams are intermittent and don't even run water part of the year.
Right.
But they said we have to have the ultimate temperature for fish. And most of our streams in Jackson County and around Oregon cannot meet the temperature standard. We're fortunate on this creek, Little Butte Creek, always did run plenty of water. It has always been a mainstay. It is the mainstay of Jackson County. It provides water to Talent Irrigation, Medford. It does all of Medford Irrigation, all of Rogue Rivers Irrigation, plus all of the irrigation along the stream.
It's important.
And it has plenty of water. There is about 40 some second feet that there's springs under Fish Lake, and those springs historically always produced about 40 some second feet of water. In fact, we had a few years ago, we had a irrigation company that was complaining that they were supplementing our water because there just couldn't be that kind of water coming out. So as soon as the end of the irrigation season happened, the water folks measured the water that was coming in, and lo and behold, there was more than 40 second feet of water in a drought year. So we never heard any more about that. That is, they dried up. But this creek does have lots of water, and it does provide the Rogue Valley with most all of the irrigation. Mm-hmm. Now we get some, and people don't realize that up above around Fish Lake, there's a ditch that runs all the way over to Howard Prairie, and so during the winter they move water from here over to Howard Prairie, which is for Talent Irrigation District, and that's a big ditch, and it runs really full.
Water is really a big deal.
And so that's how they get that water over there, and then during the irrigation season, they can do some interchanging down below on water.
So
we have water issues all the time, and the thing about it is we're getting to a point where we can't develop water anymore, because of the quote environmental standards that we have. But the problem is, if you look at it and you look at this logically, why is it bad to develop water and save it and let it run through the streams in the summer? And if you're really interested in fish, that's when you need to have the water in these streams. So that was a big issue. And in 1964, we had a tremendous flood through here. And that's how we started to build Lost Creek Dam. And we built Applegate Dam. And we finally got started on Elk Creek, and they went ahead and notched that. But that was part of the water issue we were doing, trying to build dams and trying to solve problems. Right now, if we have really heavy rain, Elk Creek runs a tremendous amount of water. So they have to shut down the other two. And of course, hopefully it doesn't run too long, because if it does, we'll have another flood on the Rogue River. But that 64 was a pretty dang good flood. I can tell you, I was right here. We're trying to keep our county government on a
a shall we say, way or mainstream that does not adversely affect us in agriculture. And they could do things with water and air and different things that can definitely affect ourselves in this county. And we are also, well, right now it's kind of over, but we were involved in the GMO issue, and we fought the GMO issue, not because of the GMO, but it took a tool out of the toolbox of the farmers. And Jackson County Farm Bureau supports all types of farming, whether it be organic farming, subsistence farming, GMO. It doesn't matter what it is. We support them all. But we had some folks that moved in, as our Secretary of Agriculture told the folks in Australia. They were farmers, gardeners that moved into the Ashland area, and they're the ones that really pushed this GMO issue. I think there is one or two real seed people in that area that could have had some legitimate problems, but when you talk to them, they really didn't have the problems that the quote backyard gardener had. So that's why we opposed that. It wasn't because of the GMO, it was you were taking a tool away from some farmers. We had several farmers that sued on the right to farm, and they ended up being allowed to keep their alfalfa, unbeknownst to the, quote, gardeners, that we had a lot of alfalfa in Jackson County. They didn't even, they could care less. All they cared about was they wanted that designation on their organic food and their GMO. But we did have a lot, and they sued, and the court said, yes, you can keep your crops until the end of the period of time that they are producing, like alfalfa, you know, 6-8 years. They can keep it until it's done, but then you can't put GMO alfalfa back in. But what it does is, on the GMO alfalfa, it allows that farmer to produce twice as much hay to be able to sell. So what in essence was done was the GMO ban that was passed cut the farmers' incomes. And I don't believe in that. I think they should be able to raise what they want to raise on their own place. And we have a lot of marijuana now that's being raised. We have a neighbor up here has 8,000 plants. And I was, during that GMO thing, I was with the head of the Department of Agriculture at Davis. And she's a really sharp gal. And she said, you know, it's going to be interesting one day. Most of your marijuana, or cannabis, as we like to call it now, is genetically modified in some way. And the way our ban was written, it will make us, or make the county, go out and stop most of the marijuana being raised in Jackson County. And Jackson County happens to produce 1/3 of the marijuana that's raised in the state of Oregon. And that was a figure I got out of the Mail Tribune. not long ago. If you're raising cannabis, we have cannabis growers, and that's fine. We've been talking up north. We put on Oregon Farm Bureau put on a large cannabis affair where people could come and learn. The only problem we have with the cannabis folks is a lot of them are not following the law. And that is, they're stealing water and taking water to water these plants where they don't have water rights and those types of things. And that's the only thing that we have at the County Farm Bureau that we can find of any problem. Now, if the federal government, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, ever comes down and starts to say that cannabis is a crop, and then they start to put on rules and regulations as to what they can and can't spray. Right now, they can't spray anything on their cannabis because it's all off label. And it has to be on label if you're going to spray it on your crops. And so when we go to spray something, it has to be a label that says we can use it on this particular crop. And when they do that, there will be the U.S. Department of Agriculture will be involved, because these people right now are doing it. They need some way to control the mites and control the mold situation they have. There's no question about it. The mites need to be controlled. And some of them are doing it, and they're off-label. They could be liable if somebody ever got sick on that marijuana or cannabis that they raised, if they could go back to them and go after them. So that's another problem that we see coming up. But as far as the county's concerned, we have no problem with the cannabis people. It's fine. They can raise all they want as long as they follow the law. That's all we care about, because we all have to do it. If we just step out of line a little, we got the State Department of Agriculture right there. They have our environmental people say, oh, they're spraying over here. That's bad. Well, as long as it's on label, and we don't have drift and those kinds of things, and we use prudent practices, then we have no problem. Mm-hmm. Even though those folks don't want us to spray, there's a lot of people that don't want any spray. But if you don't have spray, you got a real problem. It's like grain in this country, and soybeans, and corn raised in the country. Without being able to spray it, to get rid of those weeds, it's a real problem all through the whole country. The monument issue, as far as the County Farm Bureau is concerned, we have members that have permits adjacent to the area or in the area that the monument covers. And what happened in the past was the BLM began in the last monument that Clinton put in. They started to shut gates, shut roads, put up gates, shut roads, and cut permits on the permittees because they didn't want them in the monument. And it got to a point that they were saying, well, we're going to end up having to give this thing up. So one of the environmental groups, and I don't know which one it was, I don't remember, I've heard, but said, well, we'll give you so much for your permit, and we'll give it back to the federal government. And so it was, they like to say, a voluntary turnover of the permits. Well, it's not what I call a voluntary when they're holding a gun to your head, and it's going to put you out of business. because of the cuts. And that's just what will happen again in this next monument expansion. It will run. One of the guys is five or six generations right here in Eagle Point. It'll run him out of business, no question about it. So that's a real problem. And we also have the problem of fire. Without maintaining the roads and gating the place, the roads and that kind of stuff, it makes it harder to fight fire. And that's a real concern, because we get all this smoke in the valley, and it's really hard on a lot of people. But we're kind of really due for a big fire over in the Ashland area, where the monument is. There's a lot of brush growing up, and that tends, and without cattle in there, you tend to have more grass. And so if a fire gets started, it burns, and it's really hot, so that it tends to go higher on the trees and kill more trees and do that kind of stuff. So that's a big issue for us. And also, the county should be concerned in the fact that it's taking revenue away from Jackson County and the Common School Fund for the state of Oregon. That's pretty important, that we maintain our schools, or at least try to maintain our schools. And by taking the ONC lands in a checkerboard manner, which does not make any sense to me, but what it does is it prepares for another expansion of the monument, because we'll have a lot of people left inside of the monument, and a lot of them will want to get out, and it kind of goes up and around, a big arm up like this, and they'll want to block it all in. And every time you do away with one of those private lands and it goes into government hands, there's no more taxes. So it costs our county and costs each one of us more money in the county. So that's a big issue with us. And then they have the other one over in Malheur County that's going to take, I don't know, it's either 40 or 60%. The Ohi Monument is going to take 60%, up to 60% of the county. The counties are the only members of the Oregon Farm Bureau. Okay, so I think there's 32 counties, or 32 county farm bureaus in the state, covers all the counties. They are the member for the Oregon Farm Bureau. The counties are the ones that tell the state farm bureau what to do. And we have a policy book, and we come up with resolutions at the county level and send those on to the state level, where the local, when I say that, the state board on that particular issue, whether it's livestock, whether it's fill and removal, whether it's aggregate, whatever the issue, water might be, taxation, gets a hold of it, and they get to look at it and say, well, this makes sense and this doesn't. Then they send a note back to the county telling us why it did, this part didn't work, but we'll forward it on, but we're going to edit it out. But they leave it there so that the whole House of Delegates, and we have a House of Delegates once a year, can see what was originally written. And we may not agree with the particular group. When I say group, I mean taxation, maybe. We don't agree with their thinking. And so we will say, no, we want to leave that particular wording in so that we can work towards this down the road. And so we'll leave something in, even though the committee said no. But the full House of Delegates sets all of the policy. We set all the policy. Then we have, and we elect representative, regional people, and they're on the board of directors of the Oregon Farm Bureau. And we have our president, vice president, we have three president, first vice president, second vice president, third vice president. The first vice president runs the convention. The second vice president handles national affairs, and the third vice president handles all of the committees in the state. And so, you know, we always have some expertise from the board on all the committees, as well as members of the local county farm bureaus. Our local county farm bureau meets for a community meeting where we try to surface issues that may be something that we need to talk about in the county, or we need to educate membership. Something's coming up and we need to be talking about it so that the membership can be on an equal par with the folks that are bringing that issue forward. So we do that at our county, and we meet once a month, the third Tuesday of month. And then we also have a board meeting once a month, and that's where we take care of the nuts and bolts of the operation. In other words, we look at the budget, we keep the things that have been authorized to pay. We pay the bills, and you know, we send out the membership billing. We do everything that you do in a typical corporation at the board meeting. If we don't know our county government and our officials, then we can't go to them and say, here's our problem, and be able to sit down and visit with them on a one-to-one basis and explain what our problems are. And that is something that we need to be able to do inform them of what our policies are, both county and state, on a particular issue. Doesn't matter what the issue is, but we need to be able to have that back and forth so we can educate them and they can educate us, is what it amounts to. And it's very, very important. And we do the same thing with the state. Next month we happen to have a senator coming, Herman Bearsugar. He's part of one of the senators in Jackson County. He will be at our County Farm Bureau meeting. And it's going to be a Christmas party, but he'll have a minute to say a few words, and we'll just sit and visit. I mean, you know, people visit, and you get to know them, and so if there is a problem, you can go to their office and talk to them. Yeah. And that is just, you just can't imagine how important that is.
Yeah.
I think the effectiveness of County Farm Bureau depends upon the people in that particular County Farm Bureau. And those people in that County Farm Bureau deal with the issues that come up. We have been working very hard on our Young Farmer and Rancher program. It's a program that they have a meeting and they learn about farming, same as we do, their meeting, young farmers, ranchers, they have to be 35 or younger, and we're fortunate we have a very good young farmer and rancher person, and I see that as our future down the road. They're learning, and the more they can learn and be informed, the better farmers and or whatever farming turns into will be down the road. The actual farmers tends to be, in the County Farm Bureau, tends to be just holding its own. But we have several types of membership, and those types of member, we have an associate membership, and that associate membership is something that was developed when we had the insurance company. And we sold the insurance company to Country Company, and when we did, we kept a relationship with Country Companies. And so if you're a member, you want to have a Country Company policy, you have to be a member of the Jackson County Farm Bureau. And so it's worked out good for them, and it's worked out really good for us. And we have, last year we had 4,944 members in Jackson County in the Farm Bureau. So Jim, that's... What do we get? Anything exciting?
I never looked in it.
We got the Capitol Press.
Yeah.